Meeting at, it's just 9 o'clock on February 25th, 2000. It's 10 o'clock, yeah. February 25th, 2013. We're going to bypass the pledge because we already done it this morning. Clerk, would you call roll?
Supervisor Brown?
Here.
Supervisor McCowan?
Here.
Supervisor Pinches?
Here.
Supervisor Jurdy?
Here.
Chair Hamburg is absent by prearrangement. Supervisor Pinches presiding.
Okay, before we move on to agenda item number two, I'd like to show you our display of our new painting here in the board chambers. It's a painting from 1902. It was painted north of Laytonville. I encourage everybody at a break to come up and look at it and lead the.
Do you know anything about the people in that painting?
Yes, can you tell the rest of the story?
Well, the person in the center is my great uncle, and the one on the right is the artist, and his brother's on the left. And when my dad said when he was a kid, that tree in behind there was a sign on it that said it was the largest live oak tree in California. I don't know if that's really the truth, but there used to be a sign on it. That's the road north before it was called 101 going north of Laytonville. So I think it's nice to have a scene from Mendocino County in the board chambers. And I'd like to thank our CEO, Carmel Angelo, and especially Al Beltrami, our former CAO. He paid for the plexiglass covering over it, so it's a real addition, I think, to the boardroom. And we moved the seal here in front of the chairman's seat so the camera would be focused on the seal. So anyways, with that, I'd like to ask Supervisor Brown to read the Women's History Month proclamation.
Thank you, Vice Chair Pinches. And I do have a proclamation of the Mendocino County Board of Supervisors recognizing March 2013 in Mendocino County as Women's History Month. Whereas Mendocino County women of every race, class, and ethnic background have made historic contributions to the growth and strength of our county in countless recorded and unrecorded ways, and whereas Mendocino County women have played and will continue to play a significant role in every sphere of the life of Mendocino County by constituting a significant portion of the labor force working inside and outside of the home. And whereas Mendocino County women have played a unique role throughout county history by providing the majority of the volunteer force, particularly important in the establishment of charitable, humanitarian, and cultural institutions of the county. And whereas Mendocino County women served as early leaders not only in securing their own rights of suffrage and equal opportunity, but also in the industrial labor movement, the civil rights movement, the environmental movement, the peace movement, and more recently, the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgendered equality movement, all which seek a more fair and just society for everyone. And whereas Mendocino County women currently hold significant leadership positions, including countywide elected positions, seats on the Board of Supervisors, seats on area city councils, and numerous other seats as elected and appointed members of boards and commissions. And whereas, despite these contributions, the role of women in history has consistently been overlooked and undervalued in the literature, teaching, and study of local history. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Supervisors of the County of Mendocino hereby proclaims March 2013 as Women's History Month in Mendocino County and invites the public to honor important women in our community at a celebration to be held on Sunday, March 10th, recognizing their local contributions. Dated February 26, 2013. Actually, it's the 25th, 2013, and signed by our Vice Chair, John Pinches. So, I have ladies here that have come as a group. I'd like to present the proclamation and invite you to speak if you so desire. So, here I come.
Val Mahowski, Philo, California. I'm delighted to accept this, and hope you can all come and celebrate Women's History with us, which is happening on March 10th. We're having a celebration at the Saturday Afternoon Club at 1 o'clock, and we're honoring women who in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Women inspiring innovation through imagination. We have some women here today, and we were wondering if we could take a picture with you.
Absolutely, come on up. Getting a little closer. I think you're going to be a little closer. Thank you, ladies. Is there anybody else from the public want to speak on this? Thank you, Val. Is there any other member of the public want to speak? Any board members have any comments? Okay. This is automatically adopted, so we don't need a vote, right?
Right.
Clerk, yeah. Okay, thank you. Okay, we're going to move to adoption of proclamation recognizing weights and measures in Mendocino County during National Weights and Measures Week, March 1st through 7th, 2013. Supervisors McGowan and Jerdy are sponsoring this, and the Agriculture Commissioner and Sealer of Weights and Measures are the sponsors. And Supervisor McGowan will read the proclamation.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chair. Proclamation of the Mendocino County Board of Supervisors. Recognizing the importance of weights and measures in Mendocino County in observance of National Weights and Measures Week, March 1st through 7th, 2013. Whereas consumers in Mendocino County are entitled to and expect to get what they pay for when making purchases and/or conducting transactions, and whereas business owners in Mendocino County are entitled to and expect a level playing field with respect to similar transactions whose value is determined by the commercial measuring and or weighing devices they own, as well as similar devices owned by their competitors. And whereas equity in the marketplace and having the true and accurate measure of a good or service is a fundamental aspect to the functioning of a free market economy and protects consumers and business owners. And whereas weights and measures officials nationwide endeavor to keep the playing field level in commerce and to protect the consumer from possible overcharges due to short weight or delivery of product, as well as verifying the accuracy of electronic pricing systems. And whereas on a daily basis, the people of Mendocino County engage in transactions that have the costs calculated using a commercial weighing or measuring device, of which just a few examples are gas pumps, store checkout scales, bulk delivery of propane or petroleum products, and propane meters. And whereas the Division of Weights and Measures for Mendocino County works faithfully to maintain equity in the marketplace and assure that the consumers in the county receive the full volume, measure, or computational value they are paying for, Now therefore be it resolved that the Board of Supervisors of the County of Mendocino hereby proclaims the week of March 1st through 7th, 2013 as Mendocino County Weights and Measures Week. Dated February 25th, 2013, John Pinches, Vice Chair. And we have our Ag Commissioner and Sealer of Weights and Measures, Chuck Morse, here to receive it.
Don't look like anybody wants to take a picture of you, Chuck.
Oh, yes, we have Mr. Merritt there.
Absolutely.
I'm up front, Ray.
But they want to capture this moment. So let's see if we can all be in the picture here.
Go ahead, Chair.
Thank you, Vice Chair Pinches, members of the board, CEO Angelo, County Council Parker, and staff. Greatly appreciate Supervisors McCowan and Jerdy sponsoring this proclamation. It's National Weights and Measures Week, but it all comes to roost here locally for us and for me particularly, obviously, as a sealer. It really gets down to you can boil it down to two basic fundamental concepts. You've got all the consumer protection out there. So if you're buying a gallon of gas, or you're buying a pound of apples, or you're getting a bill off a propane meter on the side of your tank, or you're getting a bill at your door off of a propane truck that delivered bulk propane, or whatever the situation might be, the consumer can rest assured that they're getting the volume that they're being charged for. The other fundamental aspect is equity in the marketplace. So if business owners should feel confident that their competitors are also held to delivering the same quantity and protection in that way. So again, I greatly appreciate it. And I wanted to introduce Ray Harry. Ray's been an employee for 15 years here in Mendocino County. He's been doing mostly weights and measures. He is a biologist as well. So he helps our office on some of the ag side programs as well, but basically Ray's been our weights and measures inspector the whole time, and I think all the business owners in the counties know as soon as they see the felt hat coming, and Ray can't sneak up on anybody anymore in the business world, so he's been a tremendous asset and continues to be just a fantastic asset for our department.
Thank you. Is there any member of the public want to speak on this item? Any board comment?
Yes. It not only protects the consumer through this program, but it also protects businesses that may not know that their scales are off. So thank you so much for all your work, Ray. Really appreciate it. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. We'll move on to the next item, which is public expression. Are any of the members from the public want to speak on any items that are not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll move on to our next item. This is an informational presentation on annual report from CAL FIRE. Our Mendocino unit chief is here. Supervisor Brown, you're the sponsor. You want to start this off?
Yes. Thank you, Vice Chair Pinches. We usually have this annual report, and I spoke with Mr. Rowney a while back, and he said he could come here in February, and so I'm so glad to see him here, and we're gonna hear the report, and then I do have a question after the report.
Okay, Chief Rowney.
What's being handed out, there's actually three or four different pages of statistics, and of course we all know depending on how the question is asked you get different numbers. Probably one of the key numbers that we have first of all, I think for the supervisor's sake, is the incident totals based on districts. And that's the one that lists all of the various fire districts and companies that we dispatch under the county contract. And the reason I felt that was really important to outline was of course, because for each of your respective districts, you may have an interest in how, what kinds of pressures are being placed on what are essentially volunteer departments. There are very few paid departments in this whole listing. And of course, actually on the coast, for example, I think the Fort Bragg is the only one with paid personnel. And mostly they are dependent on volunteerism. So I thought it important that you recognize the contribution that our local fire agencies provide to the overall protection of the people of Mendocino County. There's the another page there is the agency incident report, and it has this rather odd looking alphas alongside of it, but it does give the total number of actual incidents that the contract that we provided through the contract to the county, and the total last year was 9,670 total incidents. Of those, as is normal for most fire agency dispatch systems, over 70% were medical aid, and that's very, very common, and actually it's a little low. More fire departments typically are in the 80 percentile, but of course if you start adding in hazmat and some of the other public services involved, you do hit the 80%. So fire agencies and ambulances are not necessarily all just fire. But the 9,670 total is pretty much where we typically expect to be. We generally run from the about 8,500, 9,000 to about 10,000 calls annually that we process through our dispatch center. I would remind you that what your contract provides in this system is five comm operators. And those people are state employees, but they are paid under the Schedule A contract that we have with this county. So there are essentially five people who are there as a result of this county's efforts. What the normal national standard is for comm ops is on the order of 1,500 calls per comm op. So we're just about consistent with what the expectation would be at our call center. And there is also a breakdown of the incident types by agencies, just a simple little pie chart, again, just to get an idea how, what kind of issues are there are out in the county and how we are managing those. We also ran a quick, and there was a second page there that unfortunately I remembered just after I stapled everything this morning, was the incident report by Cal Fire Station, because these local agencies are not alone, and so a lot of those structure fires, for example, our Ukiah station responded to 626 structure fires. A lot of those were within Ukiah Valley and or the city. Same thing, you see a fair number in Fort Bragg, as well as our engine responding out of Howard Forest, probably mostly to the Willits area, but also down into Potter Valley, places like that. So that'll give you an idea of the kind of service that your contract is providing. We think it's a very effective mechanism to provide coordinated response and effective response to all sorts of emergencies. We are an all risk, as they call it, agency, and we encourage a continuation of the program. You may be aware that we are going to expand our capabilities actually starting next week, this Saturday actually, for Ukiah City. We will be picking up their fire and emergency services dispatch along with two additional people. Their call volume is, we're expecting to add about 2,300 calls annually to the dispatch floor. So it will require one additional person on the floor during peak periods. So we're still looking in terms of when those calls occur during the day so that we can work this shift properly to assure continuous response to everyone that's calling 911. So that's a general idea of what it looks like, and if you have any questions, be happy to respond to them. Oh, and one other thing I should point out, I brought with me George Gonzalez. George, you might just stand up. He is our new administrative officer for the unit, so if you have issues regarding the contract, you could certainly call me, but George is the guy I'm going to talk to anyway. So he's new here in the administrative role since January, since Ryan Grable retired.
Thank you, Chief. Any questions or comments from the board?
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank you again for being here today, Chris, and I really appreciate these totals, and they're all encompassing, and it'll be nice fireside reading to go over all of them. But I do really appreciate receiving this information, and I want to thank you for your service to Potter Valley and being first on scene at a very deadly fire that we had last fall downtown Potter Valley. Really appreciated it, and I know you were headed out elsewhere to do a memorial walk, and but thank goodness you were on the road and able to get there very quickly. I do have a question, and this actually came up at our meeting, off-site meeting in Fort Bragg last fall, and I'm just wondering the contract request for proposal for Jackson Demonstration State Forest, the recreational user survey. Is it still on target for release in April?
We sincerely hope so. It's a unique contract, and that was one of the problems we were having. We actually brought in our personnel from our business services office in Sacramento, had a very lengthy meeting with the head of business services to try to figure out what it's going to take to get this contract on the move. And part of the problem was is that what we're looking for out of that contract is really a proposal. So it's a contract for a proposal to do a contract.
And
it was something the contracts personnel were having trouble with, because we felt we should keep it as open as possible for potential information gatherers to design their own system in terms of how they would be going about defining the nature and intensity of various recreational uses of the forest. And that was something the BSO had never dealt with quite before, but we said it's critical to us. So we believe we've gotten past that hurdle. So yeah,
great.
We're very hopeful to get that. Actually, we'll probably get a report on that on the 27th, this Wednesday. The Jackson Advisory Committee will be meeting over at BLM offices here in Ukiah.
Oh, okay.
And so we'll probably be talking about, that will be certainly one of the topics.
Great, because the recreational use of that state forest is a really important component.
Very much so.
Yeah.
Yes, it's certainly one that we recognize as being a critical component of the forest.
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Supervisor Brown. Any other comments or questions? Thank you, Chief.
I should point out couple of other things, just for your edification. I did talk briefly with Supervisor McCowan, but this year we will be opening the new station at Boonville, and we'll be working diligently at trying to ameliorate the impact of a very bright, shiny fence, and we recognize that's an issue. However, we just got the keys to it literally just weeks ago from DGS, and it's going to take us a little bit to, and I just actually talked to the Chief Mark Stewart, the battalion chief for the area, and said, okay, let's get some plans designed, because we do have to resolve that. We know it's a community impact, and we're looking to ameliorate that. The other significant event we had was a little construction work up in Laytonville, in your area, Supervisor Pinches. And we've renovated our engine bays up there to accommodate the new engines. So every year we see a new design, they get bigger, they get taller, they get longer. It's a bummer, but it's what we have to deal with these days. So we're pretty excited about this year. We should have our helicopter back here in about 2 months. And we'll have both fixed wings up. And of course, we are a little concerned about the weather we've seen thus far. Currently, there's a almost 300 acre fire in the Owens Valley area. So these are things that don't typically happen this time of year, but we're seeing some aggressive fire behavior already. So thank you.
Thank you. Any members of the public want to speak on this item? Okay. Thank you. We'll move on to discussion of possible direction to staff regarding an informational presentation, initial introduction on approved source issues related to locally grown food. Our Agriculture Commissioner, city sponsor, Chuck Morris.
Thank you.
You want to start this off, Chuck? You're the sponsor of this, so.
Sure, thank you. Good morning. Chuck Morris, Ag Commissioner, Sealer Weights and Measures. Members of the board, CEO Angelo, County Council Parker, staff. The Environmental Health Director and I are here this morning before you to, as you said, give an informational presentation on approved source. We're going to kind of tag team it a little bit back and forth, and the document that was passed out will is a duplication of what we're going to present today. But it, hopefully at the end of this, we'll receive feedback from the board about proceeding forward with this effort. So I'll hand it off to Dave.
Okay, we have Dave Jensen from us. Thank you for being here this morning, Dave.
Thank you, sir. David Jensen, Environmental Health Director. Honorable Supervisors, CEO Angelo, County Council Mr. Parker, staff. On behalf of Agriculture Commissioner Mr. Chuck Morris and myself, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to come before you today. We would like to use these few minutes to introduce you to the regulatory concept of approved sources, to explain why this concept is important to small farmers and retail facilities, and to share with you a proposal that Commissioner Morris and I have developed and which we are willing to pursue with the direct help and involvement of local stakeholders. It is our hope that you will receive our proposal positively and allow us to pursue this matter. I would like to start by emphasizing that our goal is to develop and implement a practical, no-cost program that will protect food safety and legally open up new markets to local produce growers. We will work with local stakeholders to develop an approved source program that is based on a set of best management practices. Mendocino County produce growers will be able to self-register on a county website. Growers will be expected to self-certify that they are following those best management practices. This program will apply only to farm-grown produce. It will not include the sale of meat or dairy products. Participation will be voluntary. So what is an approved source and why are they important? The California Retail Food Code, which I have here with me, commonly referred to as CalCode, sets the rules for the operation of food facilities within the state of California. These are the rules that my inspectors enforce for restaurants, schools, community events, farmers markets, even the county jail. One of the basic requirements for all food facilities is that they purchase their consumable supplies, their feed material, if you will, from an approved source. For most food materials, such as canned goods, milled grains, meats, and dairy products, there exists a complex array of regulatory agencies and a body of regulations that are intended to ensure an acceptable level of food safety. CalCode says that any licensed producer or processor who complies with those regulations and is inspected by those agencies is deemed to be an approved source. An approved source can legally sell their products not only directly to the consumer, but also to other retail facilities. On a personal note, when I owned Calix Ice Cream Company, I received my dairy products and flavorings from approved sources. I was licensed by the California Department of Food and Ag and was regularly inspected by them. As a result, I was qualified as an approved source. This enabled me to open my market to include other retail food facilities such as Frankie's Ice Cream in Mendocino, J.D. Red House in Willits, the Little River Inn, North Coast Brewery, and others. The ability to expand my sales into other retail accounts was vital for the survival and the growth of my business. Unfortunately, there is no practical legal path for the expanded marketing of produce by small farmers. The regulations that govern today's agribusiness were not developed with the unique needs of small local farmers in mind. Local farmers simply cannot afford to comply with those regulations. They can sell their produce at farmers' market, but CalCode prohibits them from legally being able to sell their produce to a food facility unless they become an approved source. Fortunately, Cal Code leaves the door slightly ajar by stating that you can become an approved source if, in the absence of applicable laws, you conform with current public health principles and practices and generally recognized industry standards that protect public health. The state of California has not enacted legislation that reasonably enables small produce farmers to sell their crops to retail facilities such as restaurants, schools, nursing homes, or hospitals. We do not suggest that the county of Mendocino do so either. Instead, we are proposing to follow the lead of other counties in developing a workable, affordable, approved source program that is based on best management practices, self-certification, and product traceability. We hope to work with produce farmers, produce growers of Mendocino County to develop a set of practices that will conform with current public health principles, a recognized standard of conduct that will protect public health and which will enable local growers to qualify as an approved source. Our goal is to find a practical and affordable way to enable Mendocino growers to legally sell their produce to restaurants and other food facilities.
So both Director Jensen and I have engaged the Mendocino Food Policy Council and made them aware of our initial efforts to develop this approved source program here for Mendocino County produce growers. We anticipate the initial draft of the program will be very similar to those to that already established in Napa and very soon to come online in Sonoma County, as the fundamental issues of traceability and pathogen reduction, et cetera, are similar, obviously, everywhere within the state. Currently, the Napa and Sonoma County programs are cost-free, and they allow for a self-certification process to become an approved source. Although this program would obviously be for Mendocino County growers, we're aware of the regional consequences as well. Mendocino County is, as I'm sure you're aware, is a member of the North Coast Regional Food System Network, and two of its five member counties obviously have this program in place at this time, that being Napa and Sonoma. Sonoma soon. Given the coordinated effort with the North Coast Regional Food Network, we anticipate the ability for approved source growers to be able to market their produce outside the county boundaries and still within the five county regional network as well.
The three pillars of our approved source program will be adherence to a set of best management practices, self-certification, and product traceability. I will say a little bit more about each of these. Best management practices. As Commissioner Morse has stated, our program will be very similar to those of other counties. That said, it will likely have that famous Mendocino twist to it. The Code of Best Management Practices will address the following main areas: worker sanitation, field management, and post-harvest handling. Based on basic public health principles and the work of other counties, we anticipate that worker sanitation will include basic practices such as washing your hands after using the toilet, the use of gloves to protect produce from sores or open wounds, and perhaps the exclusion of workers suffering from contagious diseases. Field management practices. These will likely address items such as the timing of fertilizer application and the reduction of crop exposure to pathogens whenever possible. Post-harvest practices will likely address the use of clean containers and the safe storage of harvested produce. In all cases, the focus of these best management practices will be the reduction of foodborne pathogens. Self-certification. Self-certification will enable us to offer a no-cost practical program that can operate with no additional county staffing required. Environmental health personnel will not inspect personal private farms. Each farmer will be responsible to verify that they are complying with the conditions of this program. Product traceability. Product traceability is the key to the success of the approved source program. In the event of a food illness incident, Environmental Health will be able to quickly trace the contaminated produce back to its source. We will then work with the grower to take immediate corrective and preventive measures. We anticipate that we can achieve a reliable system of product traceability through a set of simple, low-cost, practical steps, such as paper invoices that are retained for a minimum length of time. Finally, it is important to remember that this program will be completely voluntary. It will apply only to produce farmers. It will not address meats or dairy products. Any produce farmer whose business model involves only direct sales to the public need not be part of this effort. This is only intended for those who wish to legally sell their produce to commercial food facilities.
So a reasonable question at this point is, how are we going to try and do this? The Department of Agriculture and the Division of Environmental Health will develop the approved source program in conjunction with interested community members. We will host a series of stakeholder meetings throughout the county to provide information and receive feedback to guide the development of the program. We anticipate a variety of participants, restaurant owners, producers, obviously, other institutional purchasers, hopefully, for our local produce growers. Public involvement will be solicited through the development and implementation of this program with the help of the Mendocino County Food Policy. And I would like to just say that Director Jensen and I were before them in January to introduce this basic concept. They were very responsive to that, and we're grateful for that. The Department of Agriculture and Environmental Health will work with GSA's Environmental Services team to develop an online registration platform to facilitate the program. So far, we have met and reviewed and analyzed the current programs that are in place with both Napa and soon to be online Sonoma. We've met with a limited number of stakeholders at this point in time, trying to just formulate a very rough structural overview. If the board agrees, we will proceed with the initial round of stakeholder meetings, hopefully in early March. We'd like to get this going as quickly as possible. We will continue to hold public meetings with roughly a two-month interval. That's what we envision now. We're hoping for that between each round of meetings. Our hope is that after three or four rounds of meetings, we will be able to craft an acceptable program that has broad public support. And we're hoping to bring a final program before the board in September.
In summary, the Agriculture Department and Environmental Health are working together to develop an approved source program that will protect food safety and legally open new markets for local produce growers. We will work with local stakeholders to develop a practical, no-cost program that is based on adherence to best management practices. The growers will be expected to self-certify that they are following those best management practices. Participation will be voluntary. We will meet with information services to create an online registration platform. We will hold several rounds of stakeholder meetings. We will provide information and receive feedback, and together we'll develop a formal program. We will also closely watch the progress of similar programs that will be implemented this summer in Napa and Sonoma counties in order to learn from their experiences. I would like to leave you with this quote from Brad Banner, the Director of Environmental Health in Butte County. Brad states, "I want our organization to be viewed as a partner with the local food movement rather than as an adversary." I know that Commissioner Morris and I wholeheartedly share that sentiment.
Great.
Thank you. Well, I personally think this is great news, not just good news. This is great news. And I personally thank both Chuck and Dave, I mean, for taking initiative to move this forward. This is I've always wondered, you know, why it's easier to get our letters from Salinas rather than is the guy that has 10 acres of it across the street or whatever. So it's, this is really, and the part that I like about it, it's the process. It's not going to be a real burdensome process to go through to do this. It's basically a good farmer with putting out good, clean produce can do this very easily. So I think this is great. Any supervisors have a comment?
Yes, I do.
Supervisor Brown?
Thank you. Yeah, and I want to thank you both for your leadership on this issue, and didn't get to hear all of your presentation at the Food Policy Council, but came in just kind of at the very end. But I really do appreciate it. And I think it's a real positive step towards local economic development here in this county. And it's also going forward with the five-county effort with the Food Systems Network that former Supervisor Valerie Brown and I launched. Oh gosh, has it been 3 years ago? I think it has. As a result of receiving a USDA rural development grant, part of a statewide initiative with different regions of the state, looking at different types of economic development. But I'm sure going to watch this. If I can help in any way with your meetings or, you know, sitting down with groups, I'm ready to volunteer for that. I'm also, it's probably my announcement, but my next job in life is going to be, I wanted to be a farmer at the farmer's market. So I'm looking forward to this, and maybe I'll have more opportunity in my retirement years to expand that. But thank you both very much.
Supervisor Journey?
Yeah, this is a pleasant surprise. I'm glad you guys are both working on this project, and I'm glad to hear that you were at the Food Policy Council. And just to be sure everybody here knows, that there is actually quite a bit of agricultural productivity on the Mendocino Coast. I mean, think of the coast as being overcast with fog, but actually with hoop houses and other methods, greenhouses, people were able to grow fresh produce and vegetables. And I see in the audience we have one of the co-founders of the Noyo Food Forest. I don't know if you intend on speaking after having come back here from the she was one of the stars of Women on the Land, I think, was the film, and just back from the film festival in Denver. And so maybe Susan Lightfoot might want to say something too.
Supervisor Jurdy, tale has it, and history shows it, the coast was a great producer of vegetables. I guess it would be post reclamation project for Central California, and then they just couldn't compete because of the transportation issue and the lack of having good transportation for their products. So yeah, I think there's some real opportunity for coastal people as well.
Well, when you put the word local in front of any food product, it gets the attention of every consumer out there, and it's really
absolutely.
So any members of the public want to speak on this item? You got a pretty good introduction, so I wish you'd introduce yourself.
Thank you, Dan. Good morning. My name is Susan Lightfoot, and I am the Farm to Fork Coordinator at North Coast Opportunities, which means that I am the person who helps facilitate these relationships between local farmers and our commercial purchasers, including schools, hospitals, restaurants, grocery stores, caterers, etc. And in the last year of my work on this project, this approved source issue has continued to come up, in that all of our commercial purchasers know that it's something that they're required to do and haven't known what the rules are for our local produce growers. And it's been a real gray area, and in those gray areas is, you know, a space where those purchasers get leery of what they should do, and so then they're a little bit less likely to want to buy from local growers because they don't want to get in trouble, they don't want to get any fines, they don't really know what they're looking at, what the landscape is. And so I think that the development of this program is really going to be a step in the right direction towards building the local food economy that we all wish to see here in Mendocino County. And I really want to laud these two fellows here who have been, like Carrie said, real leaders in this program. And I've been working with them over the past month or so in discussions about this, and they've both been, you know, incredibly enlightened about it. And it's been a real positive experience for me as someone who's working on these issues within the community, working with both farmers and purchasers, to know that we have allies in the local government who want to work on these issues with us. And as we've been talking about recently, we really see this as an opportunity to build trust between the business community, local farmers, the purchasers, and local county government. Because there's some fear out there, especially around environmental health with farmers. There's been a lot of things that have happened in the last couple of years in the food safety realm, mostly on the federal level, not at all having to do with county government. But, you know, just kind of a spirit of fear that's a little bit pervasive throughout our community. And I see this as a real opportunity of building relationship and transparency and partnership between local government and local business. And so I really think this is a great thing for us to be moving forward to, and particularly the process in which they are proposing of hosting a series of stakeholder meetings to really gather input and to get buy-in and participation amongst the participants who will be the ones who are affected by this policy. That's really key, rather than it just like, here, this is what we want to do, because then it goes, what are they doing? Instead, like really pulling everyone together and saying, what does this mean for you? How does this translate to the farm? You know, what does this mean for the buyers? I think it's really going to build us in the right direction. And what you were saying about the coast is really key, because as you know, our farmers markets are only in, you know, May through October primarily. We have a couple of winter markets in the county, but the coast is not. And those off-season sales are really key for building business for local farmers. And the commercial accounts are where that business is built. And so by having this approved source program, it's going to help build the year-round market for our local producers, and that's a really key step in developing more of a stronger, healthier local food system. So I'm all for it, and you know, as a member of the Food Policy Council, we are really excited to also be working in partnership with the county government to make this policy happen. So thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public want to speak? Supervisor Brown.
Since there's no one else, I'll speak again. Susan is just one example of this great group of county residents, whether it's through their jobs or not, that are really bringing this to the forefront and really working hard countywide and regionally on this effort. And it makes me feel really, really good. It's kind of like back to the future.
Supervisor McCown?
Well, and I just want to say, obviously, I concur with everything my colleagues have said. And unfortunately, Chair Hamburg's not able to be here today. But I know that building our local food capacity is one of his passions. So, you know, thank you. And, you know, you certainly have the full support of the entire board. So thanks for all the work you're doing.
Thank you. Yeah, and I'm going to say it one more time, Chuck and Dave. I really appreciate this. This really sends a strong message that Mendocino County is in the business of helping businesses out there, and we're bending over backwards. And I personally really appreciate it.
Thank you, Supervisor Pinches. And just two things, real quick, to Supervisor Gerardi's comments. The Department of Agriculture is hosting. We do every year a session out in Fort Bragg where all those producers out there can get their certified producer certificates for the markets, and we fill up a full day. It's a very long day, and sometimes we have to do a day and a half just to cover all the producers that are out there. So
Yes, the coast is still very active in production. And the other bit is we're planning on three regional meetings, and we're hopefully going to have one of those meetings in Fort Bragg if we can coordinate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on to our next item is the acceptance of the 2012 Building Activity Report from Planning and Building Services. We have our Planning and Building Director here, Steve Dunnicliffe. Steve, you want to make a few comments on this?
Members of the board, Steve Dunnicliffe, Director of Planning and Building Services, and I don't have a presentation for you today per se, but I am available for questions. I wanted to also let you know that it's been a very interesting exercise. As your board is most likely aware, this information hasn't been compiled or released in this fashion in the past, and so what we found is it took us an awful lot of time to get this pulled together in what we felt was sort of a logical manner. And it's ultimately led to a lot of questions that I don't have answers for yet today as I'm before the board. But I would be very interested in any feedback, or comment, or questions that you have with regard to the format of the document, information that's laid out or not available, that type of thing.
Any questions or comments from board members? Supervisor Brown?
Yes, thank you. I found this to be very informative. The format works for me, especially the graphs kind of give you a really good idea of where we've been and where we are and what has happened within probably less than 5-year period. But I did appreciate it very much. The only question that I did have, and I tried to go back and find it and got tired of looking, but on the very last page it says type of planning applications, and the first one is ag preserves and zoning. Mm-hmm. What's MHRB, mobile home something something?
Mendocino Historical Review Board.
Oh, got you. Okay, thank you very much.
Supervisor Jerry.
So thanks for putting together this report, and I think you gave a report earlier, or I saw a report earlier, that showed the number of building permits issued by the two offices, the Fort Bragg office, the UCI office, and I don't think it's in this variation of this report.
The only information that I've seen to that extent is the number of inspections per inspector, and so yeah, that's something that hasn't been broken out, but I'm not aware that we have anything on the number of permits issued by department. That's another interesting thing that has become apparent is these different reports provide and track different types of information. So we don't necessarily have apples and apples that we can break out across the board. For some reports, we can track, you know, dollar amount per different offices. For some reports, we can track activity by individuals. But we don't have a real consistent, availability of data across the board.
I guess the question comes up is if there were three building officials in Ukiah and two on the coast, and the coast was issuing half the building permits, I mean, that becomes an issue. So that's why I think it would be helpful information to see that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, Steve, I appreciate this pretty detailed report, really. It kind of tells you where your department's going. I mean, or you need to know where you are before you can tell where you're going. Like in code enforcement, it basically shows some problems with maybe need to pay more attention to that or whatever, but I really appreciate it. It was great. Supervisor Brown.
Thank you. And somewhat in response to Supervisor Jurdy, staff goes back and forth depending who has the heavy load and help each other. I believe permits that are coastal may come inland because staff's available and vice versa. So, you know, it's great teamwork, and I just remember that. I think it was former planning director Nash Gonzalez that explained how everybody interacts with one another to take up the load or the slack, et cetera, et cetera. So,
any members of the public want to speak on this? Been awful quiet this morning, Mr. Sackwood.
Okay. Is that bad?
We can accept this report. Do we need a motion on this? No. Do we just accept the report? Thank you, Steve. Okay, supervisor reports. Supervisor?
Oh, I don't have mine with me.
Tomorrow.
Oh, well, it's on the agenda today.
Okay. Okay.
One thing I'd like to, I think, opportunity, I'll take the prerogative of the chair here for a minute. We've seen this morning three of our department heads come forward, and they're relatively new to this county, but I think it's a real breath of fresh air in how progressive they are, and I just want to convey to our CEO and staff and that I guess I can say you can really pick them. But I'm really impressed by all three of the gentlemen that were here this morning and what they're, how they're trying to move their departments forward and do things that's good for the public, and it's, I'm really pleased with it. So with that, we're going to, I guess, adjourn to, it says here we're going that we're going to adjourn to lunch, but can we go into closed session?
At 1:30.
And not till 1:30?
It's a timed item, Mr. Vice Chair, so 1:30 would
be. So I guess we'll adjourn for lunch and be back. We'll report out here first, and then we'll have to go into closed session, right? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
We can convene directly into closed session.
Okay, so we'll adjourn to lunch now and convene directly into closed session.
Yes, the board could do that.
At 1:30. Okay. Thank you.
John.